friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Say and just thank the Lord for it.
Camp.
I'm going to find that camp one these days.
You know how I love camp.
Yeah. I'm going down there to that cabin and stash out for a few days.
Joe has a sanctuary, a place that he can get away to. Nice. Anything else that people are really grateful for?
I'm thankful for another day.
Another day.
Give me another day.
Take for granted every day of life.
No.
I'll tell you what I'm thankful for.
Yes, sir.
I am thankful for the people that God puts in my life. And I got two buddies that I hang around with, and we go on road trips a lot. We was all
They're
gone
legendary.
All day. Yes, we was gone yesterday. I thank God for them and for the joy that we have together and just good times that we have together.
What makes life special are the relationships.
Yep.
With them. With
yes.
them.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
And with the people that we still
absolutely.
Have here.
Yeah.
And I know that you know, Gary, how long has it been? About 6 months since Miss LaVeda passed away?
October 11th.
October 11th. And, tell you what, it's a lonely world.
Yeah. I didn't realize it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Married how many years?
60 years.
60
wow.
years.
Yeah.
yeah. So.
60 years with her.
Wow. And the joy of the Lord is to know one of these days we're going to see the Lord, we're going to see them again. This old world. It's not our home. We're just passing through.
What a day that'll be.
Thank you. It's just a half step lower.
That's okay.
did you have one? I see you with your book still open. Okay. This is what music, I mean, this isn't just formality that we do when we come together. We again believe that the early church, it talks about that they sang. You remember that the disciples following the Last Supper said that they sang a hymn and then they went out. Music was an important part. That's why you got in the Bible the entire book of Psalms, which were songs that were sang. You can go back to the Old Testament. They actually had choirs, but that was what their responsibility was, to provide the music. So music is just an important part of worship experience. So it's not like we're taking up valuable time here doing something else. This is worship. Worship, being reminded, it's not only praising God and giving God the honor and the glory he deserves, but it's also something to inspire us to keep serving the Lord, keep looking ahead. Things may get bad down here. In fact, I think they're going to get worse. Jesus said so. Those that end up thinking that things are just going to eventually get straightened out are discounting what Jesus said. Things will get really bad, but the good news is there is coming a day when all of this stuff is going to be, there's going to be a new heaven and there's going to be a new earth. So keep the faith. If there was another song, we'd sing another song. If not, we'll go ahead with the service. No additional songs? All right, so speaking about going ahead with the service, just announcement-wise, this Tuesday, out there at West Liberty Christian Church, they've got the men's prayer breakfast. If you've not been there, I highly recommend it. It's at 9 o'clock in the morning. There'll be somewhere between usually 13 and 21 guys. I think 21 is supposed to be had, right?
That's last month.
Joe and Orion, they typically prepare the food every month. And this month is going to be traditional. Am I allowed to say what it's going to be? Because they try to vary the menu. This time, he said it's going to be like biscuits and gravy and scrambled eggs and, you know, a typical breakfast.
So good breakfast.
It is. It is an excellent breakfast.
I've been out there one time. Yeah.
So now that's this Tuesday. This Wednesday, we're going to have our business meeting here at the church, 6 o'clock. So keep that in mind. Thursday, the after-school program, keep Joe in prayer. He's promised the kids that they're going to make pizzas. Pray that we don't have any casualties.
I thought it went quite well when we made brownies.
Yeah. So anyhow, that'll be this Thursday. This coming weekend, don't forget, time change. Spring forward. So this week, or next week at this time, it's going to be 20 minutes after 7. And you'll already be home.
Somebody better call Mary Collins.
Yeah.
She always misses.
Yeah. Bless her heart, it was good to have her back. And then a week from tomorrow is going to be our game day here at the church at 12 noon. And if you're not acquainted with that, Gary, they get together, we eat pizza, and they play it's a card game called Five Crowns.
Sign up.
So, well, you know, even if you don't sign up, you're welcome to come, but it kind of gives us an idea if we need to get extra pizza. And it's just a fun time. It's just a time that people come together and enjoy getting to know each other and have a little fun. It typically runs about 3.5 hours, get here about noon, and most people leave around 3:30-ish. But you're welcome to stay out. So that's what's coming up this next week. Also, as I mentioned this morning, we have started this month our push for Annie Armstrong Easter offering, and it's to help support missionaries here in the United States. If you did not get one of these prayer guides underneath the offering plate at the front door, there are the prayer guides. Today, who they were encouraging us to pray for, just lost people. I dare say that America is maybe about as least Christian as it's ever been. There have been so many other religions that have come into America, and I think that the numbers are shown when they do the polls, they do research, you'll find that a lot of people are just demanding the faith. So we need to pray for lost people, and then the rest of the week there are particular missionaries that you can pray for. And any monies that we receive this month designated for that go to support those missionaries. So those are the announcements that I have. I don't know if there are other announcements that need to be made or not.
Down at the Capitol Music Hall, He's Alive is playing the 22nd and the 23rd at 7:30, and on the 24th it is at 3:30.
Okay,
and
22nd,
it's free admission.
22nd, 23rd, 24th at Capitol.
I'm telling you, if you haven't went to see it, you need to go. I don't try and miss it, let's put it that way.
Excellent. So that's in about 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And we are 4 weeks away from Easter. So, any other announcements that need to be made? No? Good to have all of y'all here tonight. Thanks for being here. We do need to pray tonight before most folks got here this evening. Chuck and Miss Bessie, it's great to have them back. Please be in prayer for their grandson, Travis. A couple weeks ago, they put a new pacemaker in. He has not been doing well with that. And today he woke up, he's got infection throughout his body. Could not bend his wrist, use his hands, his feet. And of course, pacemaker's dealing with the heart. So do keep Travis in prayer. This is the fourth time in his life that he's had to have a pacemaker. He was born fifth one. So it's not...
He's only 30 years old.
He was born with a pacemaker.
Okay.
He wasn't born with a pacemaker.
No, I mean, they put it in needed
to have
that
pacemaker
day
from birth. Yeah.
Yeah.
So please keep, he's very active out there at Open Door Baptist Church. In fact, he was supposed to speak to the men's group today, but I don't guess that he was able to. That's serious when you get infection if you're dealing with the heart. So please be very much in prayer with Travis. Good guy. Are there other prayer requests that you'd like to mention? Gary said that he doesn't know anything yet about his situation.
I know nothing yet, so.
Keep him in prayer. Battling cancer.
I need those prayers.
Amen. And Joe said that Penny is not really making a whole lot of progress. So.
Got a doctor's appointment Wednesday.
Okay, doctor's appointment on Wednesday. Anybody else? Special prayer request. I gave the folks too a report on my aunt. She is making some progress. She's kind of had a restless day. They're trying to get her where they could take her off the sedatives and whatnot. But she's still got tubes and electrodes and stuff like that. So, but she is, you know, able to apparently move, and she's responding to questions and that sort of stuff. That's very good news with regard to my aunt, Kay Meddings. So I appreciate your prayers there. No additional prayer requests?
Unspoken.
Okay. Well, let's pray together. Father, we've come together tonight in your house. It's good to be here. And as Miss Bessie said earlier, very grateful for the weather that we have, especially as we followed on the news, California being hammered with snow. And we pray that there won't be loss of life. Pray that you'd even be with those involved in rescue and keep them safe. Then we think about Texas, where the wildfires. Father, we just ask you, please send rain to put the fires out. Bless those that are fighting hard to contain it. That not only property will be spared, but lives will be spared. But we are very grateful for the way that you've blessed us, and ask your continued blessing. As we take time before we get into the Bible study tonight, we just ask you, Father, to please meet the needs of these that we've got listed. We've talked about several of them. The first one that we just mentioned was Travis Strader, and I prayed with Miss Bessie and Chuck, and Sherry was here earlier. We pray, Father, that you'd have mercy upon Travis. We believe that you've spared his life for a purpose. He came into this world with a heart that needed assistance, and he's been able to have this recent procedure. Please touch and heal him, restore him health and strength, that he might continue to serve you. Very grateful for his service to you, and pray, Father, that you'll bless those who work with him. Give them wisdom. We do pray for Gary. It's good having Gary here tonight. He's still waiting to hear about his cancer, but we pray that you would help to get rid of his cancer and bless him. Joe's wife, Penny, has just been dealing with blood pressure dropping and getting dizzy. And Father, I know that they've got therapy, trying to work with her. We just pray that her health would improve, that you would touch and heal her and help her to make progress. I again thank you, Father, for what you've done for my aunt. Ask it your continued blessing, Father, that she might be restored to complete health and strength. Bless those that are working with her. There are unspoken concerns. Here within our congregation, there are people that are always struggling with something. And Father, we ask that you might help us with those. But in addition to these that I just mentioned, there's a whole bulletin full of people that need a touch from you at this time. And we just ask you, Father, to bless them and meet their needs. We do pray for our church and churches everywhere. We pray that there can be a mighty revival. As we talked about earlier, it's discouraging when we turn on the news. We see things today that we never thought that we'd see in our lifetime. And we pray that there can be true revival, that your people might be awakened to the realization we need to get back to serving you and honoring you. And again, Father, I appreciate these that are here tonight. Pray your blessing on those. Bless those that can't be here. There are people that watch this on YouTube. And Father, we just pray that you might be honored in our lives, that we might love you and serve you. We do pray, Father, for our leaders. Pray that you'll give them wisdom, help them to make decisions that are honoring to you. And we pray too, Father, for those that are lost. Help us, Father. Give us boldness to speak to those around us, whether it's family members or neighbors or co-workers, to tell them that they really do need to get saved. Because as we've sung already this evening, we believe that the time is coming, very soon perhaps, when you will return, and pray that people might be prepared, because after you come, it's too late. So we ask you, Father, through your Holy Spirit, to convict them of their need to get saved. We pray for our missionaries this week as we've begun our emphasis upon Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We thank you for those serving around our country and the neighboring territories. That, Father, we're grateful that they've been willing to go to a place of service to witness for you. And we pray that you might fill them with your Spirit and grant them wisdom as they try to reach the people that you've placed in contact with. We pray again, too, Father, that you'll be with our military and law enforcement and keep them safe. And we ask, Father, your blessing upon the service tonight as we have a chance to open your word, that you might teach us and help us to grow more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you again for your goodness to us. Thank you for Lord Jesus coming and dying for us and raising from the grave. Thank you for giving us your Holy Spirit. And thank you for the promise that you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. May you now be honored through the remainder of the service. And please bless these prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight we go back to 1 Peter chapter 2.
First Peter
chapter 2. Mm-hmm. It's taken us a long time to go through 1 Peter. I guess you could spend as much time on something as you want to spend on it. Last week, verse 1, Peter writes that we should work on getting rid of, he names four things there. Therefore, rid yourselves of malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. I said four, it should have been five. Slander of every kind. And so we looked at that list and we found out that Peter is not the only one that talked about that list. Who were some of the other places, or where were some of the other places that we looked to find that list?
Apostle Paul talked about it in Galatians.
Yep. Paul talked about many of these same characteristics. These are negatives within the Christian life. If you allow these to grow within your life, they're going to stunt your growth. And so Peter's just saying you need to work to get rid of them. So Paul talks about it, Peter talks about it. There was one more we looked at that talked about it. Probably my favorite, came from Mark chapter 7, the Gospel of Mark. But who talked about the list in Mark chapter 7? A clue here, he died on a cross.
Jesus.
Yeah. Jesus talked about the same list. I mean, there are slight variances, but if you go over to Mark chapter 7, Jesus is addressing Pharisees and whatnot that thought that you could basically become a sinner by the foods that you eat. And Jesus says, it's not the foods that make a person a sinner. What makes a person a sinner is what comes out of their heart. And one of the things we talked about that I honestly believe, when Jesus gives us that list of things that come from out of the human heart, it is descriptive of what comes out of our heart as well, whether we want to admit it or not. Do you remember some of the things? If you need to take a look back, what were some of the things, Mark chapter 7, that he talked about? Certainly he talked about these items that we've got outlined here in the first verse. But if you look back at Mark chapter 7, there's a longer list of things that he talked about. If I turn back here right quick. He said, these are what make a man unclean. For from within, out of men's heart come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed. Here's that list that Peter puts out there. Malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All of these things, all of these evils, they come from inside and make a man unclean. And if you've not yet wrestled with the fact that they are present within your heart, you're not being very honest with yourself. And before we move past this subject, why do people engage in these behaviors? Or why do they entertain these thoughts? A simplified question. Why do people sin?
Well, it feels good. We like it.
We like it. That's all that Satan does. He appeals to the things that you enjoy. When you, again, if you go through that list that Jesus gives, why do people have evil thoughts? Do any of y'all ever have evil thoughts? I know that this morning, following Sunday school class, Lori Karras, Kevin and Lori, they live clear over in Amsterdam. It takes them 45 minutes to drive here. So they, you know, aren't maybe able to make it back on Sunday nights. But Sheila had told the story last week about a car wash. She's sitting over there. Did you have any evil thoughts?
No.
You did.
I just wanted a bird to mess up their windshield. Well, actually, a bunch of birds.
So that wasn't evil. You want to recap for them the story?
Okay, I was going through the car wash down there by the Feliz. I went to pull in. This lady cut right in front. She just cut right in front of me. She came that close, hit my car. So I had a good reason.
Can you imagine that? Somebody cut right in front of you.
So I just said, I wish a flock of birds would just go over your windshield after you get your car wash.
You said what?
A flock of birds. Good grief. So then I went home. I was going to get my car vacuumed. I thought, no, I'll just go home. It's going to rain anyways. So I went home. As soon as I pulled in the driveway, a bird came over and messed up my windshield. I was like, see, there's a reason.
Sheila, I pick on you. Well, let me just ask a question. Let me just ask you a question. Are there not any of us that when somebody has done something, we've had an evil thought? And she laughed and she said, well, it really wasn't evil. But it wasn't kind, was it?
No.
I mean, secretly, it's kind of like this person, you know, did me wrong, and I pray that. Why do we do that? Why do we have these evil thoughts?
Because we're human. We want to get evil.
Makes us feel good. It does. That's why we have those evil thoughts. Sexual immorality. Why do people engage in lustful thoughts? Because it feels good. They think that they can get away with it in the sanctity of their mind. I'm just saying, if you will go through this list that Jesus gives, Jesus just said, hey folks, I want to tell you what's in the heart. The heart of man is to do what makes us feel good. It's not about doing what God wants us to do. Again, the first sin that took place with Adam and Eve eating of the fruit. Why did they eat of it?
Because it looked good.
It made them feel good. Forget what God said. This is all about me. And so Jesus is just basically saying to each of us with regard to the sinful attitudes within our heart, hey folks, whether you want to own it or not, it's present there. They say that it's true, the middle letter, the heart of the word sin is, it's all about me. It's not about God. And what God wants us to do is say, wants us to understand, look, you continue to feed what you want, you're going to have more and more problems. That's one of the things that we're dealing with, not to backtrack on what we've discussed earlier this evening. That's what's going on within our society with all of these people that are so self-indulgent. This morning in the morning message, we brought up the fact of the furries. You know, somebody commented to me after school, you know, if they really are a furry, they don't belong in school because the school is for people. It's not for animals. You know, but why do people do that? Why does the transgender, why does the homosexual, why does, when you mentioned earlier, Dave, about the satanic people, it's all about me, 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 me. And the Bible comes in and says, do you not understand, people, that you building your life to make yourself happy is what's making a mess of your life. That's why God sent his son Jesus Christ to tell you, as long as you keep serving yourself, you're going to make a bigger and bigger mess of your life. The only way that you can really find joy and happiness and peace and tranquility within this life is to start doing things God's way. When you begin doing things God's way, all of a sudden you find out, hey, look, this is a much better way to deal with it.
I know some of those things, traffic things and things like that, I fail a lot because it's been automatic that you want to address the issue that they did this or they did that. So it's, the only thing you can do is work on it. But, it all comes back to we're all sinners.
We are all sinners, but we do need to be willing to listen to God, because if we don't listen to God, if we don't do things God's way, we're going to make the situation worse. The more that we indulge ourselves, the more messed up things are going to get. And we're seeing that clearly, not to backtrack again, but with the whole the transgender thing and whatnot. How much further do we have to go down this road till we come to understand all of this trying to accommodate people is not making things better? It's making it worse. As I said earlier this past week, in Oregon last year, they legalized hard drugs. I'm talking heroin and other things. They said, well, maybe what we need to do is just give people easier access to this stuff. Not make it harder for them. Give them the ability. A year later, they're looking at it and say, that was not a good idea, because the number of deaths has absolutely skyrocketed. And this past week, they backtracked on the legislation that they passed last year. Same thing happened in Seattle with regard to the whole defund the police movement. Police are the problem. Let's just get rid of the police. What happened when they got rid of the police? Crime went through the roof. See, the more that you give in to those things that people oftentimes say, let me have my way, it's like giving in to a little child that demands on having their way. The more that you allow that little child to have their way, the bigger mess they're going to make. And God comes along and says, the only hope for you is to understand you not only need a Savior, somebody to save you from your sins, you need a Lord, somebody to tell you how you should live. That's why Jesus says that there's coming day that people are going to come to me and say, Lord, Lord, and he's going to look at me. Why do you call me Lord? And you don't do what I say. We've made a big push within our churches. I want to say, especially within the past 30 years with regard to evangelism, we've really stressed hard people need to get saved. And that's true. They need a Savior. But sadly, within our churches, we have not emphasized that when a person gets saved, it's making Jesus both Savior and Lord. There's one coin and it has two sides to it. One side is salvation. The other side is lordship, where Jesus becomes your Lord. He becomes your master. He becomes your boss. That's where the new birth comes in. That's where you end up saying, you know what? I'm tired of living for myself. I want to die to the way that I used to live. You know, not to pick on you, Dave, at the end of the service this morning.
I don't mind.
But you came forward once again, and I see this sincere desire. It's really exciting for me to see. Because you're seeking. There is within your heart, amen. There is within your heart a new desire that has not been present within your life. And it's kind of like, wow, this is just unbelievable. And that's what God wants to do within all of our hearts and lives. As I said before, not to scare you or anything like that, you're kind of in the early Christian stage.
That tickles me to death to be a part of that.
It does. Yes. But I say this because those of us that have been around Christians have seen people go through stages. There are stages of Christianity, and there's it's kind of like the honeymoon stage when people get married. And all that they can see is the perfect side of the person that they married. And then there comes the stage that you wake up and you realize, I got a whole lot more than just the good side. I got the downside too. And you have to learn to love the person, the whole person, not just the part that appeals to you. All right, you left on. Any comments? Did you like? No.
All right. Bacon thing I told you about. Why the good ways like bacon?
Oh yeah. You can just.
Why is it, a good wife can be compared to bacon because she's beautiful to look at, she tastes delicious, and she kills you slowly.
I can see that on a bumper sticker.
It's been slow.
Or on a t-shirt.
9 years.
Oh my. Okay. Thank you very much. We'll keep that in mind.
You can put that one in your pocket for later.
I'll do that. So anyhow. Jesus has said that you need to work on getting rid of these things. Paul said that you need to work on getting rid of these things. Peter says that you need to get rid of these things because they do keep you from growing into the likeness of Jesus Christ. And to get rid of them, you need the Lord. It's not just a matter of acknowledging him as Lord. You're going to need the Lord's strength to overcome those things in your life.
Song like that somewhere.
Yes, sir.
Need the Lord.
Absolutely. People need the Lord. Absolutely. You're going to need the Lord to give you his strength, his wisdom, empowering you to overcome these things because you will not conquer them in your own. So moving on to the second verse of 1 Peter chapter 2. Peter then says, I've given you a list of things that you need to get rid of. Now let me give you some things that you need to add, he says in the second verse. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. There's a couple of passages of scripture that talk about milk within the Bible. And I mean apart from the Old Testament. If you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting with the first verse, Paul, in writing to the church at Corinth, does anything stand out in your mind about the church at Corinth? I think back years ago, I got a kind of a set of commentaries. I don't know if I'd call it commentaries, but it was books that Chuck Swindoll had written about, you know, various books within the New Testament. And I think that the maybe the title of the book, if it wasn't the exact title of the book, it was kind of giving you the theme of what the book of the Bible was about. And he said that the church at Corinth was a scandalous church. One of the reasons that he said that it was a scandalous church is because of what takes place in the fifth chapter. What was the scandal that took place in 1 Corinthians chapter 5? It was about the man within the church.
Sleeping with his mother-in-law.
Stepmother.
Stepmother, and it was something like that.
And the Apostle Paul was just absolutely, how in the world could you people within the church allow something like, and he said the sad thing about it, rather than you as a church being offended, and by the way,
like
he said
within
society, the people outside the church don't even live that way. Not only did they go along with it, they were proud of it.
Yes.
You go back and you read, he says, you people are just unbelievable. That's one of the reasons he said it was a scandalous church. And so the recommendation that he gave was to do what to this man?
Put him out of the church.
Put him out of the church? To be mean? No. To tell the guy... To tell the guy, look, this is serious.
Straighten him up, maybe.
Absolutely. And from what we read later on in 2 Corinthians, the second letter that we have that the Apostle Paul wrote, and they think that there might have been another one. But at any rate, the man apparently did repent. He had a change of heart. And I said that this was similar to the sort of behavior that you see with the Amish people. When the Amish people get somebody within their community that begins to get outside, they shun them. They do. They put them out. And it's something to hopefully get that person to think about what they're doing. And so that wasn't the only problem that was going on within the church at Corinth. What were some of the other things? What was that, Joe?
I said, whenever you rebuke them like that, it's, what it's actually to do is to draw them back in instead of.
Exactly.
It seems like it's the other way around. Yes, you're kicking them out, removing them from the church, but it's actually to draw them back into the church, what the response should be.
The intent of the church is never to destroy a person. The intent of the church is to get the person's attention so the person doesn't destroy themselves. Because I think that what the Apostle Paul would have said to this guy, sir, if you think that you're going to go to heaven behaving like that, I got news for you. You are not going to make it to heaven. Because your heart has not been born again. When you have been born again, there is a responsiveness and a receptivity to the Spirit of God. And so that was not the only scandal. If you talk about other scandals that took place there within the church at Corinth, they had problems here within this third chapter. You're going to see they were fighting over which guy was the better pastor of the church. Some thought that Paul was, some thought that Apollos was, and Paul was like, my goodness, this church is not a popularity contest. Church is about us working together to build the kingdom of God. And he basically scolds them. He says, look, neither Apollos nor I nor anybody else really amounts to anything. The only person that really amounts to something is God. All of us are nothing more than just servants. You go over to the 11th chapter where he talks about the Lord's Supper. What was going on with the Lord's Supper there at the church in Corinth?
They were...
The Lord's Supper was not as we celebrated this morning. It wasn't just a little, you know, wafer and a little, almost
yeah,
like
tells
a...
tells them if they were hungry, yes, eat at home before you come.
They had people, they would actually have a meal and people would show up and they'd pig out and they didn't care about anybody else. What were some of the other things? There within the church, some people felt like that their gifts were important and other people's gifts weren't important. And they looked down and some people said, well, I'm an eye and you're a hand and so on and so forth. The Apostle Paul says, look, everybody's important within the kingdom of God. They had disorganization there within the church. They practiced, you know, the speaking in tongues. And the Apostle Paul said, look, when you get together and there's the speaking, and some people have been to churches here in the valley, that there's the speaking in tongues, and they can either call them a charismatic or an apostolic church. You go there, and I've heard people talk about it because I haven't had the opportunity to go. Because I'm usually here. Gary's back there shaking his finger. No. Why do you say that? Because what I've heard from those, they're chaotic.
It is.
Person walks in from out of the street, and my goodness, everybody's just doing their own thing. Some churches will get so emotional, you got people out there dancing and, you know, roll. Gary says he's seen them
roll around the floor.
And you know what? The Apostle Paul says this is no way for the people of God to act. Not right for the people of God. So I'm just saying, there's even more stuff in the book of Corinth. It was a scandalous church. It was a church that really had a lot of problems and he had to straighten them out. So here in the third chapter, this is what he says, and this goes back to the subject of milk that Peter writes about in 1 Peter chapter 2. He says, brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly. You're not concerned about spiritual matters. You're thinking like the world. In fact, he goes further, he says, you're thinking like babies. You're being a bunch of crybabies. You're thinking like mere infants. Why did he say that in Christ? He said, I gave you milk, not solid food, because you weren't ready for solid food yet. I don't know a lot about parenting. Some of y'all have been down that road. When a baby comes into the world, you have to get their digestive system built up. You don't, as soon as they get born and put in the nursery, bring them a steak. It's a long time. And he says, really, this church that the Apostle Paul had worked with at Corinth, he said, I wish that you were in a position that I could feed you more solid food, but you people just, you absolutely amaze me how infantile you are in your thinking. And then he goes into the infantile thinking that they're experiencing right now. In the third verse, he says, you are still worldly because they're jealousy and quarreling among you. So what are they jealous about? What are they quarreling about? He says, are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another one says, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men? And there have been churches that will end up deciding which leadership person they want to rally behind. And the Apostle Paul says, you know what? We can't move on to more important things in the house of God until you people stop focusing on these petty issues. He goes on to say in that chapter, he says, I'm nothing and Paulus is nothing. It's God that we're here to focus on. And we need to give our devotion to God and our loyalty to God. And we need to be listening to what God ends up saying. He says, I wish that you were in a position that I could talk about some of these other things, but I'm having to start ground zero with you folks. He says, put all that stuff aside. Understand that we are all here as co-servants, co-laborers with God. Now, I don't even ever want to become so puffed up that I think that I'm not the most important. Every part of the body of Christ is important. I've just been given a particular function within the body of Christ. But every single one of us are important for the building up of not my kingdom. This is my church. This is the church of the living God. This is one passage of scripture that he talks about milk. There's one other passage of scripture that I'd like for you to take a look at. And it comes from the book of Hebrews. Of course, we're talking, our lesson tonight is from 1 Peter chapter 2, where Peter ends up saying that like newborn babies, we should crave pure spiritual milk. The passage of scripture that I want you to look at from out of the book of Hebrews comes from chapter, I think it's chapter 5, I think. Take that back. Let me look. I had it earlier. Yep, chapter 5. Down at the 11th verse. And it also goes into the 6th chapter. But and there are those that feel like Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Some people don't feel like they wrote it. Regardless, the Holy Spirit is the one who inspired every single writer to write the books of the Bible. We don't need to attribute it to, you know, a particular person. We need to attribute the writing to the Spirit of God who had them write it down. But this is what he says in the 11th verse of the 5th chapter. He said, we have much to say about this, but it's hard to explain because you people are slow to learn. And again, he's writing to Christians that are coming from a Jewish background. He says, there's a lot of things that I'd like to talk to you about, but you people have kind of been slow to learn. Keep going in the 12th verse. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. We're going into the 6th chapter. So you might say, well, what is some of the milk that they were still trusting in? The milk that he talks about in the 6th chapter, he says, therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings. Elementary school, elementary teachings like elementary school. That's when we went to first grade and we had to learn our ABCs. And we had to learn how to count. We had to learn our multiplication tables.
That's right.
But you want to move past that to where we graduate from high school to prepare us. Sadly, I don't think that the kids today are being prepared like they used to be. And it's obvious. But he says, we need to move past the elementary, the beginning stages, and go on to maturity. And here he talks about the things that they were still struggling with. He said, not laying again the foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death. In other words, you don't need to tell people, you know, about the basic sinful stuff that'll lead to them dying. You know, hey Joe, I don't know if anybody's told you, but it's not a good idea to kill people. And Joe, I don't know if anybody's told you that it's not a good idea to take drugs. And Joe, you know, he says, let's move past all that stuff. Let's get to what's going on within the heart. These people were kind of starting at the beginning point. He says, let's not go back to turning away from those things that lead to death. Let's not go back to, well, I just believe in God. Let's not go, not that there's anything wrong with God, but that's a starting point. Our belief in God is, if you go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, it says, for without faith it's impossible to please Him. For those that believe that God is must believe that He is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. In other words, you know that if you're following God's plan, God's going to bless you. He will reward you. And so He's saying, let's move past this beginning thing of I believe in God. Let's move past the thing about instruction and baptisms. I hope and pray that by this time, everybody understands baptism is not going to save you. Water baptism is not going to save you. Baptism is not a ritual that you do to get yourself into heaven. Baptism is symbolic of something that will get you into heaven when there has been a new birth within your life. The baptism symbolizes a death, a burial, and a resurrection. That the person has died to the old way of life, they have been raised to a new way of life. And Paul is saying here, if this is Paul that wrote the book of Hebrews, he's saying, listen, there are still people in the church that they haven't got that. I still get that. You know, people wanting to get baptized. Even, and this isn't to be an indictment against the kids, because kids are curious. I get that. But at our after-school program, from the very first day that we had our first session, we brought them here to the church, and I brought them out front here to the sanctuary. They came out here to the sanctuary, and all of a sudden, there was something out here that caught their eye. And every single one of them went running up on the stage. Those of you that were here can remember that. What in the world is this? I told them, that's about baptistry. And then all of them were like, I want to get baptized. And I'm not against kids getting baptized, but I want them to understand that when you get baptized, this isn't just a fun ritual. It is a statement of your faith. And I told the kids a week ago Thursday, I said, because the whole baptism thing came up, and I said, listen, it is a serious decision because you are making a commitment of your life.
When you come out of that water, you're a new person. If your heart is right, you're a new person.
Absolutely. And you are a committed person. That's what I was trying to stress to these kids. It is one of those things that you are making a statement, I want to follow Jesus Christ for the rest of my life. And know people say, well, that's a hard and heavy lesson to put on little kids and whatnot. But it's true. What is the song that we sing? I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
No turning back.
And one of the things that those of you that have been in church along with me, we've seen many times, and I'm not discouraging children from getting baptized, because I was like 7 or 8 years of age whenever I followed the Lord in baptism, that I got baptized. And I've stayed active in church. But those of you that have been in church like I have, you've seen kids many times that I think they really had no idea what they were doing. And I'm not going to fault them for that, because, you know, we were young. It's very important. Of course, my father was a pastor. I had people within my life that helped me to stay faithful to that commitment. We are a new person in Jesus Christ, but there also needs to be a commitment to Jesus Christ. There is no turning back. There is no turning back. And so he says, hey, folks, we need to move past baptism. We need to move past laying on of hands. We need to move past the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. There needs to be other things that we need to discuss within the kingdom of God. And so Peter ended up saying, hey, folks, it's about growth. We'll finish up tonight. If you'll look back one more time, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2, he says, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. That you might grow up in your salvation. You want to grow and move beyond the elementary stuff. The proof as to whether or not you have moved past the elementary stuff is whether or not you're able to represent Jesus Christ and teach others by setting an example for them. You don't need somebody telling you what to do. You already know what to do. You have moved past the learner state. You are now in the teacher state. You don't need somebody to teach you. You need to be passing on what you know to others. That's the sign of maturity. We use the same thing within our society with kids, that hopefully by the time that they're 18 years of age, they're ready to get out on their own and they're able to function as responsible adults.
That's what it is to be a disciple for God.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so that's what Peter's goal is there. That's the goal of the Bible. You know, I've been told as a pastor, the greatest compliment that I will ever be paid, and I will tell you too, the greatest compliment that you will ever be paid is when you can turn the ministry over to somebody else because they have matured to the point that they can now be a leader. The goal within Christianity isn't to so that I be a leader. The goal within Christianity is give the leadership away to others that they are capable of leading. And Peter says, hey folks, that's the goal that we're after here. And the way that you do it is, he calls it craving spiritual milk. Paul talks about doing away. But those things that are going to help us to grow in our maturity, that we might more fully represent the one that we serve, that people might see Jesus Christ through our lives. So do you have any questions or comments about the Bible study tonight? Yeah. We've got one more verse. Go ahead, Joe.
Yeah. The analogy you made about somebody cutting you off in traffic or whatever, it's a very good analogy. And the one thing I've learned in my life about that particular analogy is, you know, when somebody does that to me, I've learned to have compassion on them. Because I'm going to tell you what, sometime, and this just happened a week ago, I cut a guy off down Walsburg. And I'm sorry, I wanted him to stop because I want to apologize to him. Because when I do it, I want him to have compassion on me. And because I know sooner or later I'm going to do it. So when somebody else does it to me, I don't get upset.
That's good. That's good.
But yeah, I pulled right out in front of a guy last week in down Wallsburg, and oh, if it wasn't for his being attentive, I probably would have pulled right out and got hit.
Thank the Lord that you didn't. Thank the Lord.
You have to watch apologizing though, because they might be in road rage.
Hey, you're right. Within the past month, I saved a story. I think that it took place in a Walmart parking lot here somewhere in the United States, that a father and a son, and I think the guy was in his late 50s, they were going through a Walmart parking lot, and a car was backing out, and they didn't see him, and they accidentally hit the guy. It didn't leave a mark. It didn't dent his vehicle. It didn't leave a mark. But he felt bad that he'd hit this guy's vehicle, and he got out of his car to go apologize to the guy. The guy got out of a car with a gun, shot him in the head, and killed him.
Oh, my goodness.
We are living within a society that is very, very violent. And we do need to be understanding and patient. All of those gifts of the Spirit that the Apostle Paul talks about, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, against such there is no law.
I'm good with letting it go. We're all good with letting you go.
Yeah, I'll let it go.
But here's the thing. When it first, the spontaneous comes out, the spontaneous, I say, oh my, you know, I got to control myself better, you know, with things. it's working better.
Praise the Lord. And the more that we grow in Christ, the better we'll work, and we'll find that the Lord's ways are best.
That was the key right there.
Absolutely. Yeah. The Lord's ways are best. And once you begin to experience that the Lord's ways work, the more of the Lord's ways you'll desire.
The more they work.
The more they work, absolutely. And the more you'll appreciate the Lord's presence within your life.
So I tell a lot of people that I talk to that I have the devil. He sits here on my left shoulder. The good Lord's over here on my right shoulder. I'm just about deaf over here. I don't hear him at all anymore. I'm just about totally deaf. Yeah.
Well, that's good. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. We all are tempted. Yeah. Even Jesus was tempted.
Don't so he's always working at you.
Yeah. Don't believe these people that basically want to tell you that you're going to reach the point that you're not going to be tempted. Remember that Jesus was tempted even up to the Garden of Gethsemane. Yep. You know, and he was praying, sweating as it were, great drops of blood. Father, if there's any other way, I really don't want to go through this, but if this is what you want, I'll do it. So please understand, it's not a mark that God is not with you if you're tempted. It's just that you've got to learn to stand strong in your faith and in your convictions. And as you act upon what God leads you to do, you'll find that his ways are always right. In fact, as it says in the Word of God, his ways are not our ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are God's ways than our ways. They may not look right, but God's ways are always right. So, yeah, thank y'all. Thank y'all. Hey, let's have a closing prayer. Father, it's been good tonight as we've had a chance to look at your Word and reflect upon Peter's words. He had a heart. If you go back and read the first few verses of the first chapter, these people, Christians that are scattered in various locations, he had a heart for Christians because Peter, too, was a Christian. He knew what it was to flounder in his faith. He knew what it was to mess up. And he says, hey, folks, you can grow. That's one of the things that I commented when we began the study of Peter, that I was amazed that God, that you had taken this ordinary fisherman. And it's not to be a slam against fishermen, but, you know, he was probably, fishermen are probably most noted for telling tales, probably wasn't real honest, and maybe that's, you know, reading stuff in, but, and it's probably also stereotyping, but you'd taken this guy that was an ordinary, many times he was brash, you know, he boasted about, you know, he wasn't going to leave Jesus Christ, and he had fallen on his face more than once. And yet, Lord, you continue to work in his life. And so when he writes this letter to Christians, I believe that he's speaking from a heart that he understands people. And he's telling us, as he told the people back then, get rid of those things in your life that are keeping you from being like Jesus and pursue those things that will help you grow into his likeness. May we, Father, take seriously what he is saying that we might grow to be more like Jesus Christ. We ask your blessing upon our lives as we go forth this week, that we might represent you well, not that people might see us, but that they might see you in us. And may people come to Jesus and get saved. Dismiss us with your blessing. Bring us back the next appointed time. And until then, use us for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.